So neighborhood operation-based spatial filters is our objective to learn those. And you guys hopefully will be able to design and implement different types of spatial filters at the end of this topic. So why are we interested in these spatial filters? This is a motivational picture. What do you see in this image? That's my question to you. What is wrong in this image, or what is not pleasing to you, or what could distract us from the main information in this image, right? That's the first question. Noisy, exactly. Yeah, thanks, Batuhan. It looks noisy, right? There is this graininess, what we call, yes. Because that comes from grain type of noise in the old style films, photographic films. Even if you picture, imagine yourself, even if you picture a homogeneous, a constant looking, constant color, for instance, constant white, whiteboard, a table, something, some plane like that or object, you would see such effects, right? This is like the background noise in a way, this grainy noise. In a maybe it's easier to understand it through music or sound, audio processing, let's say, in a very quiet place. Put your microphone, assume there is no sound. Even then, in your recording, there could be some background hiss, right? Actually, you would hear that if you pay attention, or if you do some special types of processing. That's called background noise. We see that kind of graininess here, right, over all these homogeneous, supposedly homogeneous regions. They are not really homogeneous. So the goal will be to get rid of all this undesired information because it contaminates our images. It may be due to different things, the reason of getting this, because now we are not working with, of course, a photographic plate, like a physical picture sensor, but now we have digital sensors, right? We have our digital cameras, the light is converted into an electrical signal, which is sampled, and then, of course, the noise can appear, can be introduced in many different stages of this process because it's sampled, then it's also quantized. And here, let's see, I mean, these are a little bit exaggerated, but let's assume your camera took a picture of this, look at my mouse, of the signal original image part here. It is, you see, this image when you view it from like a 3D perspective, this is actually, you view it as a graph. It's a 2D space, and then your signal value or image value is viewed as the attribute or the f of xy, what we would call, right? It's, or I of xy is viewed as a graph, we say it. So in this view, we can see the amount of actually jaggedness, or the, like, look at the background noise. Again, what I was talking about, this background noise levels. If you exaggerate it a lot, you see it's even now interfering with our data or the information that we're trying to extract from this picture. For instance, from this picture, we would probably want to read the text signal, right? But we can't if there is a lot of noise. So most typical random noise, I mean, it's all kinds of fluctuations, because it's typically when we talk about light signal being converted to electrical signal, light rays, remember, it's photons, right? The photon fluctuations, they are all these minute, minuscule fluctuations, thermal noise, and all these kinds of things when being converted from light to electrical signals in our sensor arrays. All these devices may be introducing some kind of these minute or minuscule noise effects. So we have, even if you see we image a patch like this, a constant patch, look at this image here, we would, if we measure Let's say we normalize it to around some mean, or I was going to say to zero, but just don't normalize it. There is a mean value. Here it's some gray value. Then you would see, actually, ideally, you would want a delta function, right, in the histogram, a delta distribution. Histogram, remember, is a approximate probability density function. But here, with this background noise, you would see a non-zero standard deviation, right? We remembered our Gaussian PDF last time. So this amount, this standard deviation may change, of course, with respect to the settings of the camera, things like shutter speed, like aperture, like the amount of light that is falling, right? It's the amount of aperture opening. Shutter speed also affects it, because again, it is telling us how fast or how slow this scene is being imaged and things like that. So you see here, actually, the amount of noise increasing in these patches, okay? I mean, I think this is a very straightforward question. Which of these image patches has a higher standard deviation in its noise histogram? This was just a warm-up question, but I think we can just skip it. You would say A, right? You can see this, apparently. As noise level increases, so does the, of course, standard deviation. This is another question I'm asking the class each year. Say you have a static camera continuously viewing your scene, and you assume there is nobody moving, no moving object in the scene. And this is from our beautiful cultural center, Süleyman Demirel Kültür Merkezi at İTÜ. This is a very nice picture, I think. Nobody is in there, no object is moving. I'm asking you, how would you measure the background noise level of your camera? Do you have an idea? For instance, one idea is record this as a series of time frame, image frames across time. That is called a video or image sequence. And look at the difference between consecutive image frames and plot its histogram, or actually PDF approximation. So actually you would get something like this, right? So this would be image histogram, intensity histogram of differences between consecutive frames. That would give you an idea of how much change is happening between images, and you would really get a feel for the amount of noise, background noise, its standard deviation. You would probably see something like this, actually, some Gaussian. You know, we love Gaussian density, right? It really helps us model many physical phenomena. So you see here, even for modeling things like image background noise, it shows up. Of course, different physical processes may have different, may be modeled by different probability density functions, but Gaussian is the most common one, which is nice. Okay, so that was it. We have other kinds of, by the way, images, not only digital camera or optical images. We have ultrasound images. Maybe in the future you guys will see this. When I ask this typically to my students, nobody has had an ultrasound scan before. You guys are still young, but it's becoming more and more common as you start to have some checkups and things like this. That. So you see, this is this time sound waves being reflected, and you see another kind of noise. This is speckled noise. You would have to go through other types of processing, either to get rid of it, or sometimes actually here the medical experts, doctors don't want us to get rid of that. So they say, I am used to this noise. If you clean it for me, I'm not really happy with it. So, because you may be getting rid of important medical information. That's the trick. That's why you have to be careful in cleaning noise. It has to be really getting rid of the redundant information, but keeping the desired information in the image. Then there is optical coherence tomography, for instance, this time optical light waves being reflected, though. And you get, again, this is the images of the retina, similar speckle looking images. So you see, for these guys, then you don't use Gaussian, but other types of, for instance, Rayleigh type of PDF to model those. But let's look at some probability density functions that we may use to model noise. We may say, for instance, it's completely random, then it's a uniform PDF, right? We will see another type of noise, which is this impulse, what we call impulsive type of PDF or delta PDF, right? This is delta Dirac function. It is just two, in a way, lines or masses at two discrete points. This is a PMF, of course, probability mass function. Most common is, again, Gaussian. There is rarely used also in communication channels. There is because fading on one side. Exponential is all, you remember, used for other things like when there are waiting times being modeled by Poisson processes and things like that. I'm trying to give these mathematical stuff in between because these are important for you to be able to follow. Gamma distribution is more general form of many of these distributions. With its parameters changing, you see it can take many different forms as shown here at the top right. And for instance, okay, Laplace distribution, these are mathematical expressions of many of those PDFs, by the way. You should be aware or actually familiar with all of these. For instance, Gaussian has this squared exponential minus squared form, but Laplace has an exponential e to the minus absolute value. And the parameters here, m and b, or mu and b, once you start tweaking them, you see these different forms of the function, right? And you would, for instance, want to estimate the parameters of these transforms to be able to estimate the noise probabilities or noise parametric forms. So there is this salt and pepper noise we will see. So this is actually, I'm going to show it to you soon, but let's look at some examples of these other types of distributions used as noise PDFs and added on top of our image. Let's say this is a test pattern. It has, you see, one, two, three, three great values. Now we will add Gaussian noise, Rayleigh noise, and gamma noise on top of these guys. Okay, so also you should know how to be sample from these distributions and add them on top of a data, any type of data actually. Okay, I think in our first week or second week, the histogram matching, remember, we were talking about a probability integral transformation. That is what you use to be able to transform from a uniform random number generator result. Remember, in numerical, not numerical, let's say in actually computer platforms like Python or MATLAB or other kinds of C, you know, you have random number generators, right? The libraries you use, I'm trying to remember, probably SciPy, scikit-learn. You guys probably would recall other libraries now. You would what I'm trying to say is you can get easy access to random number generators, and they typically come with uniform random number generator. From there, you should use that probability integral transform to be able to sample from other types of random number probability densities like Gaussian, Rayleigh, gamma. Okay, this is then how we would be able to add those noise densities actually, or noise distributions to our images. So now we added those random noise to our images at the top, you see, and when we look at the histograms, we really see the form of the distribution that is expected. Gaussian is typically around the mean. You see three means here and standard deviations around these three means, the dark, the gray, and the lighter intensity. And then Rayleigh has this one-sided fading form. And gamma has also a steeper, very steep one side, and again, more heavier tail on the other side, okay? So other types of noise added, exponential, uniform, salt and pepper. We'll just see what this is. Actually, it's nicely shown here. So, okay, exponential PDF is again as we expected. Uniform PDF around these three means, right? Dark gray and white, or light color is here. You see the middle gray and the dark gray, okay? Now, here, this type of noise, this is on top of each of these gray levels, flips the numbers to either 0 or 255, actually. Now, you see I have a 255 and 0 increasing in its probability. So we will look at impulsive noise now also. This will become clear. Don't worry how it's added. Impulsive noise or salt and pepper noise, similar. So now Gaussian noise, I'm hoping it's clear. It's additively added on top of the image. We will learn how to filter these types, the different types of noise. Salt and pepper noise is actually typically modeling bit errors in transmission or a random flip in intensity, maybe a round of error, okay, overflow, a zero becomes a 255 or 255 becomes a zero. So it adds this random black and white pixel spread, intensity spread. So that's why it's called also salt and pepper noise. It can corrupt any signal due to occasional inversion of a single bit, for instance, or in the intensity value, or actually it's can map the intensity to not just 0 or 255, but to any a certain intensity value to replace the image intensity, let's say eta in this case, with some probability. That's called probability of distortion. Okay, this is the model of impulsive noise. So this is really like a mask, actually, that multiplies the image, because with some probability, it's the pixel intensity is converted to eta. With one minus that probability, the image intensity stays as it is, as f. Okay? Again, it's exactly like I said, it replaces the intensity value randomly at any location by a given intensity. For instance, if it's a salt type of noise, then it means with a given probability of corruption, it converts any intensity value at any pixel location to 255, so white, okay? The higher the corruption rate, of course, the more pixels are affected. For instance, in this picture, I see very high corruption rate. Okay, so here is again the mathematical formulation with probability P0, replace the intensities with zero. Intensity at that XY location with zero, with probability P 255 replaced the intensity by 255, and it remains as it is with the remaining probability, okay? Here it's like the corruption rate would be, because there are two corruption rates for zero and 255. It would be like the average of those two probabilities. Okay, we will see how to filter these soon. Here, there is a digression slide, a side slide, because maybe, not maybe, all of you have taken the signal processing course, right? And we were, now our goal in this part of the lecture is to be able to filter these corrupted images, right? And we may now ask ourselves, because you are guys are knowledgeable in the signals and systems too, shall we do spatial filtering or frequency filtering? What is the difference? Remember, in your signals and systems course, we were working on frequency domain filtering. That is, take the input image, go through a Fourier transform, okay, and work on the, of course, we were mainly working with 1D signals there, but it's a straightforward extension is 2D and 2D Fourier transform. You get a 2D Fourier transform image. Now you can apply a filter in the Fourier domain, for instance, low pass filter, if you wanna get rid of high frequencies, or you can do, of course, other types of filters, do band pass filters, for example, wavelet filters, things like that. Then remember, convolution in time domain or space domain was a multiplication in Fourier domain, you see filter Fourier representation H is multiplied pointwise with the Fourier representation of our image. Okay. So then we do this filtering as multiplication in Fourier domain, go through an inverse Fourier transform. Of course, you could be doing some pre and post processing here too, but you get an enhanced or filtered image. But basic steps in Fourier filtering in frequency domain is this. But in this course, actually, we are not going through Fourier domain. We will be going through our filtering in space domain. Of course, for implementation, we would be, for the convolution implementation, if you use readily available convolution tools, functions in or routines from your libraries, probably at the background, their implementation is based on a Fourier domain processing. But for us, the design and the study here is in the space domain. Okay, so we will be going from an image fxy to an image gxy in this course. So why do we use these spatial filters? We've studied noise until this point. We want to remove them, smooth the image, or sometimes actually we want to enhance images. Mainly, actually, we want to do feature extraction. Although in this course, our main goal is removal or of smoothing of images, but we will also talk about enhancement. Feature extraction is also coming up in the next weeks, like edge detection, for instance. We will use edge filters, okay? So we will here smoothing filters, averaging linear filters. We will use nonlinear filters. You will learn about order statistics. The main, most common form of nonlinear filters are order statistic filters. We will look at adaptive filters. Then for image enhancement, we will use a unsharp masking, what is called unsharp masking, we will see. Sharpening filters, these are called. If time permits, next time we will look at morphological image filters. They are used widely in image filtering. In the past years, sometimes we don't have enough time, but maybe next week fully we can do filtering, so we can go over them too. And typically these filters operate on small sub-images or windows. I mean, maybe let's finish with our motivation. Why smooth? Of course, we want to reduce noise, right? And there is something called signal-to-noise ratio. We want to increase that, and it's defined in this way. SNR is signal-to-noise ratio. It's the signal average value over the noise standard deviation. So in a way, we are trying to decrease the noise standard deviation to increase the SNR, right? That's the goal. For instance, if I had an image or original signal, I mean signal or image is a signal actually, a 2D signal. Let's say the smooth original image had a histogram like this. You see it's a nice Gaussian, smooth Gaussian. Let's say I added, corrupted the image with some noise and I plotted its histogram. I see this noisy looking histogram and it's not looking like a Gaussian anymore. Now my goal after the filtering will be to be able to recover the original PDF. But I mean, of course, the noise corruption process may not be invertible fully. So I'm really getting a smoothed histogram also. So this is the histogram of the Gaussian smoothed image, for instance. Okay. Here the standard deviation was probably much higher. Now that is reduced and my SNR signal to noise ratio is increased. So we have a filter kernel or actually it's a filter. We say it's like a mask or weights. There are weights of the filter. You see it's itself is a spatial grid actually. For instance, it's a 3x3 grid, right? For 2D filtering. And you see it slides over an image and it does an operation, actually a correlation-like operation. Probably you've all seen these, right? Maybe not all of you actually. So I take it back. Most of you have probably seen such animations. So take this, for instance, mask with some weights, okay? And place it on the image and do a actually multiplication That's like correlation and addition, right? Multiply, add, and determine the value of the filter, typically at the center, but it doesn't have to be. It's however you define this operation. It could be replacing the top left pixel value too. So this is where we also were in our slides. We say, guys, we have, let's say, this original image grid. And like we said, we have a filter kernel or a filter mask with filter coefficients W. You see this W00 here is the center, okay? And then we, if it's a 3x3 filter, we have these 9 coefficients. We place this on the image and slide it, actually shift it, okay? Before shifting it, of course, wherever we place it for determining the center value of the this operation, we do a element wise multiplication. So if F was the image here, so you see Fx minus 1, Y minus 1, this pixel intensity value is multiplied by the filters W minus 1, minus 1. Okay, the center value is multiplied by W00, which is this multiplying this intensity at xy, that is equal to f of xy, right? So this is really actually showing the mechanics in an easy way. Just multiply sum, and this is showing the mechanics in as a mathematical equation. Here, one thing that's important is there is this minus sign, okay? And this minus sign could be either on the filter or in the on the image, okay? That gives us the shift, but there is also in a convolution, actually, there is also flipping of the filter. So I'm going to show that difference to you. But you see the operation, right? There is, you see S and T are changing over the image, right? So it's, we are, no, actually this is for the XY point. S and T are changing, of course, to be able to going over, to go over the filter, all the filter masks here, 9 filter masks. So this would be minus 3 to 3. S goes from minus 3 to 3, T goes from again minus 3 to 3, okay? And then we sum it up to get the intensity at the, this GXY is the filtered image actually, at the point XY, its intensity value, filter response, which is the result of convolution. Remember, we were able to also write it as, instead of this WX minus SY minus T FXY, it was a symmetric operation convolution from last year, you can see. So, I mean, this is showing some filter coefficients. My question was actually, okay, maybe first let me ask you, what could be the effect of such filter coefficients? There are two different filters here. I can ask you, what could be the effect of these two filters? Actually, I think we've already said it at the top, at the title. They are averaging or smoothing filters with different weights, meaning first this one on the left is giving equal weights to all the 9 pixel intensities, but this guy is giving more weight to the center pixel because that's where we are calculating the filter output. Also gives a little bit more weight, but less than the center still, to the two immediate neighbors and the least weights to the 4 diagonal neighbors. Okay, so here my question was, if your goal is doing filtering, for instance, averaging or smoothing, what could be the problem here? Because we will be going over the image and we may be actually doing this operation multiple times. The problem here is these image filters were not normalized. We typically use work with normalized filter coefficients. So for instance, for averaging filters, we make sure that their coefficients, sum of their coefficients sum to 1, or coefficients sum to 1, okay? So that helps us actually not to get blowing overblowing weights or sorry values in the output image. Okay, so this is again, let me see, smoothing filter mask, and you see these filters are symmetric. That's why actually I can either write x plus s y plus t, or I can use minus t s minus t. They are the same thing. And here you see we've written the filter operation as or convolution as the one on the right, on the left. This was the convolution, but with the normalized coefficients, you can rewrite it in this form where you see in the denominator now we have sum of all the filter weights. Okay, because this is the, where we try to make an average, right? We don't want to increase the values. That's why. That's why we use the one on the right. Okay. So this is a very easy local average mask. This slide was also trying to explain what we are doing. Place this mask on the image. Let's say on the right, this is your image. Of course, just a patch from the image. You see it takes values 100, 100, 103, 110, 140, 120, right? These nine values. You see you would do, of course, because this is an averaging mask, actually one idea would be just add them up and divide by nine. Of course, if you have different weights for each of these pixels, you would have to go differently. Now, once you do calculate this result, you replace the center pixel value by that intensity, and you move on to the next 3x3 block. You slide in an original standard convolution operation, you slide or shift only by one to the right. You go in a raster scan fashion, then you go down, start going down by one. This is called stride. Stride is equal to one in a standard convolution operation, but you can choose other strides, like stride is two, you would shift to for doing other, giving other effects actually, or maybe to just to speed up. You should know at the end of this course or at the end of this lecture that convolution is like correlation, guys. And we know correlation is also a very important operation in data science or in all kinds of mathematics, right? This is our filter weights, coefficients. This is our image F. You see, in this case, the weight or the image, but whichever it's interchangeable, are used as they are. Nothing is flipped. So the weights are placed on top of the image as they are, and they are slided or shifted. And of course, this multiply and add operation always takes place. As you shift, multiply, add, all the multiplication results and create the final filter value, filtered image value or intensity value. With convolution, there is a flip of one of these two signals. This is the main difference. So actually, when are the two equivalents? We've already said, guessed it, if the filter coefficients are symmetric, because flipping will not change, right? Flipping any of the two signals will not change anything. So then actually correlation and convolution are equivalent when the filters are symmetric. The correlation yields a copy of the actually what we want, but rotated by 180. So actually that's a flip in X, flip in Y direction for 2D images. So I think this slide will make it really clear. Okay, when the filter is at the border of the images, we have to do some special things. We can either replicate the image, for instance, constant, just copy, depending on size of the filter, of course. We copy the same pixel intensities to the actually borders, next to the border. So it's really like replicating and extending the image just for the purpose of filtering. Or we could take them as zero, null, not valid pixels, and just work with whatever is available. So there are some symmetric extensions in mathematics also. Yes, zero padding is one thing, or constant padding, or symmetric flip at the borders. That's also possible. These are from mathematics, partial differential equations. These are different boundary conditions. For instance, if you want your gradient to stay constant, you would replicate and you would maybe zero pad if you don't care about the effects at the borders. But zero padding typically adds artifacts at the borders, because all of a sudden, if it was some bright intensity signals there, there is a zero decrease, right? I mean, from very bright to a zero, a sharp decrease, then they typically create some artifacts. Constant padding is typically used, but it's up to you. It's up to the application also. That's typically, if you have convolution tools, that's typically an option that you choose. So for instance, now let's look at this correlation versus convolution. This is the if I hope you see my mouse, oh here, this W is the filter. It's a 1D example just for the purpose of illustration. Of course, we can do convolution in 1D, we can do it in 2D, 3D, it's extended in a straightforward way. This is a F5 coefficient or parameter filter. You see it's not a symmetric filter, so correlation and convolution will yield different values. On purpose here, a very simple signal to be filtered is chosen. It's a lot of zeros, but just one at the center. So bring this filter, place it here, because it's correlation, you don't flip it. And here you start actually just doing this overlap and multiply. And like Atahan suggested, you see in this example, zero padding is used. So here also see the reference value is actually not the center of the filter. Typically we use the center, by the way, but again, this is a special case. Here it's using rightmost pixel, because it overlaps here. Let me see where it's going to copy the result. We multiply, we get a zero, right? So let's see the output here. The output is, I'm trying to see, output will be zero. It has to be placed at, actually it's been placed at the center point. Okay, now I'm seeing, guys, what I'm looking at is G, full correlation result. So when I placed it here, actually it overlapped, and still we are calculating the value that was actually just corresponding to the filter's three, coefficient three. That's the center, you see. And now look at the result here. Zero is calculated. Shift 8, one position. Again, still zero. It's copied to G. Follow from G. So this is the third shift, okay? Now look at the fourth shift. However, they skipped it here again. It's not shown. At the fourth shift, this 8 would be on overlapping one, right? So I would have 8. At the actually fifth fourth shift, now we are in E. Yes, it was 1, 2, 3, third shift is not shown, fourth shift is shown. You see now 2 is overlapping with 1, so I have 2. Continue shifting, you have to also, of course, bring your signal at the end to the original size. What was the original size of your signal? It was 8. So you see I have to get rid of these zero paddings from both sides. You see this is the cropped correlation result in H. I hope you can see it. Now can you see the result, compare the cropped correlation result in H to W filter, which was 1, 2, 3, 2, 8. Now correlation result actually is 8, 2, 3, 2, 1. You see we get actually the flipped result with correlation. So with convolution, actually, look at what we're doing, Kofalo. We are flipping the filter, 8, 2, 3, 2, 1, right? Now we are shifting it over the image, starting from K. Look at the shifts. You see K is the first placement. L is the second shift. The third shift, actually, one will be third or fourth, actually, shift. One will be overlapping with one. That's here in full convolution result, actually. Fourth shift you see in all section, all part, all. Please look at it. The fourth shift gives me one. The fifth shift in M gives me two. And the last in N actually is showing after many steps, gives another zero. You crop again. Now you see actually in convolution, really we are getting the filter itself, because here you can think of this original signal as an identity signal, right? It's just one, zeros and one. So here with the convolution, we get the not flipped, actually, the original filter here itself. I hope this is clear. The difference is clear. Now, this is the 2D version of that, and I'm asking you a question here. I'm giving you again an image this time. It's all zeros, but at the center it's one. It's a 5x5 image. Now I'm giving you a 3x3 mask, filter mask, but I'm telling you this is a convolution, not a correlation. And please pay attention, this is not a symmetric filter. I'm asking you guys, this, look at the question mark on the right. The intensity value after the convolution, or equivalent to spatial filtering, right? After the filtering of this image on the left with this filter W, what would be the intensity value at this question mark point? Guys, can you all picture in your minds, imagine placing this filter in a way onto this image, in a way so that this guy, this block is exactly here, right? Because it has to center. This five should be centered on this, actually on this point, of course, which is corresponding to this question mark, but everybody is zero, but the filter is flipped. So can you say the result now? So we flip horizontally, we also flip vertically. It's 2D. If it was 3D, we have to flip in all dimensions. So can everybody see now it is 9, the result of this filtering operation, which is the correct, actually, or the standard classical convolution operation, its result. Guys, so imagine the convolution operation. I have to flip the filter in the horizontal direction, and I have to flip it also in the vertical direction. So actually, what which filter is going over, in a way, or which mask is going over this image, is 987654321. Okay, that's the flipped filter. So we are actually performing this operation here. We are placing this filter, which is flipped. This is flipped. Okay, we have flipped. Flip, if it's a 2D space, of course, I have to flip it in 2D. Flip in 2D. Okay, so this is really flipped in 2D. So this is flipped in 2D. Meaning now my filter, this is flipped filter, by the way. Okay. W. And remember, my image F at the background here is actually all zeros, but it had one value here. So my image value at this point was one, remember, but everybody else were zeros. So so these were all zeros. Maybe let's do it. So this was one, zero for the zero, all, so the image is in red, they were all zeros. So I think you get the point now. Guys, do the, just overlay them on top of each other, do the multiplication. So actually at this point, once you flip your filter, it's a correlation operation now, right? This is good old mathematical correlation operation. Now we write 9, so our result is 9, okay? So we do this, of course, we ship this filter to every position in the image. So we would have to bring it here. Actually, I think 9 was at the center. So the filter would be coming in this way, for instance. So probably, okay, actually it's gonna be, it's not great drawing, guys, sorry, but for instance, it would be placed in this way at the other top corner. And then actually in that case, what would be the value here? You guys tell me, what would be its value here? It would be 1, right? Because then filters 1 coefficient is on top of the images 1 value. I think this is really good to know, because this convolution filtering is something that you guys as computer scientists will use a lot, because mainly most of you, probably not, I shouldn't say all of you or most of you, but still a good majority of you will work in data processing, data science, artificial intelligence, and there you will be really doing a lot of filtering operations, convolutions, correlations, because you try to extract meaning from data, right? In any dimensions. It doesn't have to be images, but it could be any kind of images. It could be text images. You still have to make them, convert them to some numeric form, and then vectorize them or put them into tensor form, right? It could be lots of different measurements. You may be asked as a computer scientist or the data scientist, you will be asked, for instance, to write a algorithm, maybe an AI algorithm to monitor the status of the equipment, for instance, in a plant, in a big plant. Let's say it could be an electricity plant, and you may then be getting a lot of measurements from sensors, different types of sensors, temperature, pressure, cameras, you know, it could be sound, and you may then need to extract features, all of those could involve, and you would actually definitely have to do some kind of data smoothing, for instance, data filling, data processing, pre-processing, at least before going to the more intelligent levels. So please really try to understand the basics of this operation. It looks simple, but many people out there may not be aware of what convolution is doing, although currently in deep learning, everybody talks about these filters. I hope it's clear, and this idea extends to multiple dimensions, of course, okay? You are given 3 filter kernels, for which one the correlation is equal to the convolution result. So I think everybody will be able to give me which one it is, A, B, or C. Think of it on your own. I mentioned this a few times, and now you know, actually flipping the kernel or the filter is happening in convolution, but in correlation it is used as it is. Then when would they be really equal? See, guys, it's a symmetric filter. You in convolution you flip it, but it's still the same filter, right? Flip it in X and Y, so convolution and correlation are equal. So let's look at maybe the effect of the size of the filter kernel. This is also important. So let's say you are given this top left image of the A, this character, these different lines and squares. This is on purpose created, like the synthetic image is created to give, to show effects of these different filters. It's very simple image. It's filtered by a 3x3 mask here, given by 1/9 coefficients. 5x5 mask, it's a very straightforward, all equal weight averaging filter. So it's easy to write. It's all ones, but you never forget these 1/25, for instance, in a 5x5 mask. Because otherwise, your intensity values will be really much, much boosted, right? And it's not going to look like the original image. That's a wrong convolution. You have to really normalize them. So now this is a 7x7 filter. You see, we call this a large filter size or kernel size or small filter size, 3x3 versus 7x7. Look at the effects now. The top, the A, let's look at it together, is the original image. This top right is the 3x3 mask. If it's a 2D filter, but if it typically is square filter, that's why when it gives me size filter size 3, I know it's a 3x3. When it's filter size 5, it's a 5x5. So this was filtered by 3x3. This is filtered by 5x5. Look at the caption here. This guy is filtered by 9x9. This is right. Actually, I think I was going to ask you this, but already it's saying here. Anyways, this is filtered by 15x15. And look at the effect when you choose a 35x35 filter size. Do you see the effect here? The effect is blurring, right? What we call smoothing or blurring. Actually, sometimes we want this. We want to get, many times we want to get rid of these small fluctuations of noise in the images. We may want to just get rid of small details. Look at the, sorry, guys. Here, look at the image here or here and here. I can still, or even here, I can still say maybe an A. This is too exaggerated, by the way. Maybe look at this. I can still tell the coarse details, right? Or features in the image, but I got rid of these small, very small, fine details here. They are all smoothed out here, but I can really here make out the, figure out the large objects actually. So that's the idea of smoothing in a way, blurring, exactly, this is blurring. So get rid of noise, there is a trade-off there. Get rid of noise, but also blur the image. They are equivalent. Okay. So this is where I try to say, of course, don't confuse yourself. Spatial filtering is not just for noise reduction. Of course, we use it for feature extraction. For instance, object detection, blob detection. This was, again, an example from this book by Gonzalez and Woods, filtering chapter. I think most of the examples in this filtering topic is from this book, because I think the book was really covering the topic well, very well. So look at the, this picture from Hubble Space Telescope. It's a real original picture from Hubble Space Telescope. You blur it or pass it through an averaging filter, and you do a threshold, simple thresholding. We will study image segmentation, but thresholding is the most simple image segmentation technique. Let's say you want to count these planetary bodies, these important objects in this space image. If you do thresholding directly here, you would end up with a lot of noisy details. I mean, some details that may really not give you the most important features of the image. So when you do thresholding actually on this image on the middle, in the middle, you would really be focusing on the major details or major components. That's the idea actually. So typically filtering is used before feature extraction, like, or before these more high level processing like segmentation, detection, and processes like that. There are more advanced filters. We won't cover them in this class, but I just wanted to give them examples. For instance, this is a medical image, some X-ray image of the arteries, coronary arteries. These are your life arteries, actually. These guys are feeding the heart muscle with oxygenated blood. So they are very important. So their health is important. If there is blockage in these coronary arteries, it leads to a heart attack. So this is how it is actually typically monitored. The doctor takes your coronary artery images by injecting typically a contrast agent and seeing if there is blockage. This is, of course, an exaggerated filter. I just found this example just to show you what filters can do. This was trying to, this is a vessel filter, meaning you design a filter that is just targeting vessel-like structures, okay? Are you asking the borders became dark because of, was it here? Or, sorry, You are asking here, one of your friends is asking, did the borders become due to padding? Yes, that's possible actually. If you don't do an appropriate padding at the borders, you will see typically some darkening, artificial darkening. Okay, good point. So here, this is running a vessel-oriented filter, some tubular structure filter. These are looking at things like, we will study also actually structure tensors, some different kinds of higher order mathematical operations taking place on your image, and you run it through your image, and you then try to get a vessel map like this. But here, of course, you would still have to extract these bright features, right? And there is still a lot of noise. The one at the middle is maybe a little easier to understand. Out of the vesselness filtering on this image, maybe you would get the main major vascular branches. Of course, here now there are, this time you got rid of any background noise, but this time you have missing, actually you have gaps actually in your vessels, right? So you see a trade-off between this and this. Here, all these major vessels, you see these dark, actually these guys, this is a tube that is inserted to do some intravascular measurements, but this is, these are the vessels. So you see, these are continuous smooth, but here there are some gaps. You have to find an appropriate filter that would capture these vessels. Okay. So you can, for instance, create some spatial filters out of the Gaussian function, smoothing filters. For instance, you can then have this parameter of the Gaussian, right? This sigma, which is its standard deviation. Look, remember, you would always, of course, remember your Gaussian curve. If sigma is small, you have narrow Gaussian. It's more localized. If sigma grows, it's more spread, right? Because that's really giving me the amount of spread. In 2D, this is, these are in 1D. If you look at your 2D Gaussian, this is like a mountain, actually. A nice mountain. Sometimes it's like, we call it like a hat. It's like a hat, a Mexican hat or something like that. Then actually there are other functions that are called Mexican hat, because then they have also some dip at these border points between this plane and the function. But I think you get the idea. If sigma gets larger, this hill here will be more spread out, or it would be a more narrow hill or peak, right? The peak. So now what you would do is you create your filter grid. For instance, this is a 7x7 grid, right? Because I'm reading from zero, I'm going 3 to here, minus 3 to here. It's a 7x7 grid. I would create this function here with the given sigma actually. And I would then, once I define my sigma actually, I then define the filter size here in this case. Because that would tell me when my filter coefficients fall to zero, I would follow them almost to zero or very low. I would cut off the filter, of course, because normally the Gaussian will have non-zero. I mean, it goes to zero at infinity. It would have some non-zero fluctuations here, but we would design our filter, for instance, in this way by cutting out, clipping all other parts away. And for instance, this is a 9x9 Gaussian filter of sigma standard deviation of 1 pixel. You see, now I can come up with some spatial filters for averaging or for smoothing, right? For in different sizes. Okay, of course, here something is missing. What is missing in these filter coefficients? Can you tell me what is not written here? And you should If you're doing smoothing, you should include them. Yeah, they are not normalized. We would normally just normalize them by easily summing up all these coefficients here. So this would be, for instance, 30, right? Adds up to 30, this 3 by 3 filter. So just divide by 1 over, or multiply by 1 over 30, right? And then that's a normalized filter. So these are some, examples. Now, original image, Gaussian noise edit, and impulse noise edit image. Now, this is smoothed by Gaussian filters. You can say, I can choose, for instance, 3 by 3 mask or filter kernel size, Gaussian, smooth it, and I can actually redo the mask, redo the filtering. For instance, I can do 2 more times a filter by 3 by 3. This is what it says, smoothed a bit more and even more. If you continue this operation, actually it's equivalent to filtering with, for instance, on the right here, it's a very much blurred image. That's equivalent to filtering with a very large filter. Typically, we prefer to work with a smaller filter, and we can apply it many times. I hope you can follow this. So take a 3 by 3 filter, do a 1 pass, and you can maybe do a 10 pass, right? It's an iterative filtering. Then you would get a more blurrier and blurrier and blurrier results. You can keep on smoothing in this way. Or you could say, I'm going to work with a very large filter here, 15 by 15, and try to get this effect maybe at one shot. It depends on what kind of processing you have and processing power you have, computation, memory maybe you have. But the using a small filter gives you a similar effect. Okay? So, but this is, again, trying to say original image on the left. This is the noisy image on the right, top right. Again, this time it's filtering. It's trying to show the difference between filtered original image by Gaussian. Of course, it's smoothed a bit. If it's impulsive type of noise, Gauss is not the choice because it's still keeping the artifact effects, right? This is not what we want in a smoothed image. So we have to know now, for instance, the type of the noise that is affecting the image. If additive noise, this is additive noise, meaning my original image, and the noise was added on top of the original image, and this is noise corrupted image G. Okay, for instance, thermal noise, these small, remember, light fluctuations we were talking about last time when we were starting this topic. That is always there, actually, in the background. To remove that, to remove additive noise, random noise, typically we use averaging filters like Gaussian. These are linear filters. But sometimes multiplicative noise corrupts the data, like this impulsive type of noise. Now the model is original image multiplied by this noise process or noise function. Now it's a noise corrupted image, G, okay? Exactly, salt and pepper noise is multiplicative. For instance, global image illumination variations. Imagine you have a camera, let's say, seeing a room. It could be, imagine your classroom. And let's say it's actually its windows really have a good view of the sun. From the morning till the evening, actually the illumination will change, right? Or it could be even a foggy day, a rainy day. That is that global illumination variations that affect the whole room, and it will affect your scene pictures, of course. Those are more multiplicative type of noise. If we were able to find a mask of this illumination, we can try to, or if we can model that illumination, we can remove it as a mask. So that's a multiplicative noise. Also in sound signals, ultrasound, radar, all those speckle type of noise is multiplicative too. To remove multiplicative noise, we resort to nonlinear filters. I'm going to show them now, but before that, let me see. I remember we had you. I was going to say you can take the log of these two, but I'm not seeing the slide now. But maybe it's somewhere. One easy way, which is not used a lot in common practice, but take the log of this equation here, the one I'm showing. Then it will be log of g is log of f plus log of eta, right? So then you can, in this log space, but of course it's a very nonlinear space itself, in the log space, work with an additive noise model. For instance, that's one idea, but typically we resort to order statistics filters. We will go to that. Okay, let's look at the averaging filters again. We will see a few variations of these, I think. Let me see. Yes, the geometric mean. So noise corrupted image is G. We pass it through a filtering operation to get the filtered image F hat. We've already studied this actually. This arithmetic mean, remember, is that filter of all ones, of course, with some normalization, and it's here. Imagine there is a one here, right? The filter coefficient WR1 multiplying the noisy image G. And actually filter coefficients are 1 over m times n here in this case, right? And this Sxy gives us the neighborhood that this filter is operating on. Okay, so that works well on random noise like Gaussian noise, and it gives us a blurring effect. And then there are other variations. You could say, hey, instead of arithmetic mean, I want to use a geometric mean. For instance, this is another idea. Let me see, what was the geometric mean? You are in a window, you multiply this time everybody, all the pixel intensities, and you take actually a square root, not square root, but to the power 1 over mn, right? Then that's a root to the power mn actually. That also gives, actually works for Gaussian noise, that also gives you a blurring effect. So let's look at some examples, again from the book of Gonzalez and Woods, filtering chapter. This is an original image. This is a Gaussian noisy noise edit image. This is arithmetic mean filtered, and this is geometric mean filtered. And it's really hard to see any differences. They are giving similar effects, but of course here we did not have a very high amount of noise here, right? This was for illustration. Typically, of course, all these background noise, thermal noise is also actually at this level. So this is fine. But here, this slide is trying to say, let's say you had an image with a pepper noise only. Pepper noise, you see, are these black dots this time. So actually, it's meaning you only flip each pixel, randomly chosen pixels with probability 0.04, okay? Or go to each pixel with a probability of 0.04, you flip its intensity to a dark or zero. Okay, this is generally called impulsive type of noise. Apply a geometric mean filter, because those are, you go to a window, you multiply everybody with each other. You see, you are actually enlarging the darks, right? This is a very wrong filtering operation. So you should not really do this kind of operation on top of it. So also averaging, arithmetic, the direct averaging will not also work, okay, on this kind of image. So again, it's trying to recall, we've talked about this, but let's recap. In multiplicative noise, and this is multiplicative noise, okay? The noise corrupted image is F times eta, let's say, the image times the noise. Ask. One idea I was telling you, linearize the model by a nonlinear operation like the log, for instance, then use a linear filter. For instance, you can use on the log G, G is, remember, the noise corrupted image. Log G use an arithmetic mean filter. For instance, you can try this and then transform back by inverse log, right? Which is which could be, of course, taking an exponential. So typically, however, what we do to remove these speckle type of noise, impulsive type of noise, is to use nonlinear filters such as order statistics filters. What are these? Now this is a non, these are nonlinear filters. And the name implies actually, they may sound complicated, but very simple. You order the pixel intensity values in a window, and you calculate the response. Response is the filtered result, right? So let's say I have an image F here. This, look at this image on the left, and G will be my filtered image, right? I'm filling in a way the intensity values of this destination image. This is the source image. Remember, let's maybe just also tie this to our first few weeks where we were doing intensity transforms, remember, on images. For instance, to change this intensity or to fill in this image in a way, destination image, we were just looking at the intensity value at that pixel location and going through some kind of curves, right? Passing our intensity through some kind of transformation, intensity transform. Then we looked at geometric transforms where we were actually transforming this time the coordinates, the grids, right? We were, for instance, rotating the grid. Now what we're doing is to calculate the intensity value at this point, we lay or place a filter, okay, a spatial filter, which actually tells us how to affect or how to incorporate our neighbors. I was saying these are neighborhood operation-based filters or actually processing. So we this filter W, for instance, let's say in this case, of course, it's an order filter, order statistic filter. There are no coefficients. It's a nonlinear filter in this case. I'm going to now show you. But until here, we were looking at these more classical filters. For instance, we were having a local averaging filter. All of these weights were 1, 1, 1, 1, of course, 1/9. And we were multiplying them by the image intensities, so doing a weighted averaging. That's the typical convolution, actually. That's what we do when we talk about spatial filtering. But with the order statistics filters, in this case, guys, these numbers, this 69, 37, 19, 51, these are the image intensities, by the way, okay? You take these 9 intensities, you order them. So this is, this Nij is all the intensities in the neighborhood. So you just take, for instance, oh, it was 63, 37, 19, the second row 51, 43, 44, third row is 50, 56, 68, okay? Now you order these, sort these, okay? There is a sorting operation. So I vectorize them into a 1/9 vector. Now sort them from smallest to largest, 19, 37 to 68. Now I design my filter based on these order values. For instance, I can say I want to use the median filter. Median is the center value in the sorted vector, right? So for instance, now out of this median filter, my center pixel value here, location, will get the value 50. Or it could be a min or max filter. Min filter, if it's a minimum filter, that would be 19. If here it, there is a typo, probably this should be a max. A max filter would write a 68. Those are the order types of order statistics filters. Okay, exactly, Urali, you're right. There is a max filter here too. But max filter here, this is like your max pooling. So you see it's coming from the order statistics field. This is a very old field of nonlinear filters. There are some books on this actually. Nonlinear order statistics filters. I can recommend you that. That's a good one. Exactly, max pooling. But mean filter is the previous one, right? We have median. I think already you tried to say median filter, right? Mean is the averaging operation. Here you see you are not doing averaging. You look at the ordered vectors and then you try to capture or use one of the values in that ordered vector. Okay, so exactly, response is based on ordering or ranking. You can also say ranking pixel intensity values in a neighborhood. You see there is the parameter of the filter here is the size, right? And we have to specify whether it's doing a median or what kind of order it's taking. But size defines the size of the filter 3x3. It could be a 5x5 medium filter. Then I would have 25 intensity values here to be sorted, right? Yes. Okay, so medium filter, exactly whatever the size of your SXY neighborhood is here, ST are the filters coordinates, right? Here, in a way, you sort the intensities and you take the medium. It's really good for impulse, removing impulsive noise, and it does less smoothing than averaging filters, less blurring actually. You can also do a max filter and min filter. For instance, just imagine what would be the purpose of the max filter. It tries to find brighter spots, points, and it reduces pepper noise then. It gets rid of dark dots. Or min filter, it this time would remove the brighter values, right? Or like Uğur Ali was commenting, actually this max filter is really like max pooling. We may be assuming, there is an assumption there, assuming that the bright signal values are the more important features in this neighborhood. So I really want to keep them. It's like this max pooling operation in the deep neural networks. It's really actually basically you see coming from this max filter in the order statistics filtering field. So let's look at the effects of medium filtering. Image, this is the original image, top left. And this gives us the parameter, the effect shows us the effect of the parameter of the filter. 3x3 medium filter, you see the effect. 5x5, you see 7x7. Of course, now what is happening from this top left to the bottom right is details are being removed, right? For instance, I can still say in the 3x3 filter, 3x3 size filter, see there are eyeglasses of this person, but in the 7x7, actually the eyeglass feature is somewhat removed, right? I mean, it's smoothed out. You may not be so sure. I mean, you can still tell, but those details are removed. Similarly, the details in the background, look, there is this board, actually blackboard, there are writings, it's removed. On the shirt of this person, there are all these lines and patterns, it's all removed. Again, the goal of filtering is typically extract features and also going from less filtering to more filtering. This is trying to keeping the finer details to removing the finer details and keeping only coarse details actually. This is like seeing the big picture. Okay, I can see there is a guy here, but I'm not maybe really interested in the details. Okay, so this is comparing with an arithmetic mean filter. The same image, take the same image. Now filter it with a 3x3, the simplest filter. Remember 1/9 coefficients. And see the blurring, much more blurring effect, right? Here it's looking even actually when compared to this top bottom right, it's much blurrier here, less blurrier here, right? So look at the medium filtering, further results with salt and pepper noise this time. This picture was corrupted by really high probability, actually 0.1 probability of salt and pepper noise. This is showing that we can also do iterative filtering here. For instance, take a 3x3 medium filter. First pass, you get this result. Most of the noise is filtered, but still I have some left. Second pass and third pass, you see. Now look at this image at the bottom right. It's keeping almost all of the details of the original image. I think we've seen it a few slides back. And it has removed this unnecessary corrupting noise from our picture. Why do we need this? This is actually a picture of a circuit board, a part of a circuit board. And you may want to do, for instance, with computer vision, automated inspection of the circuit board. And these systems are in practice, actually, in the field. You may want to see if all these soldering, all these wire connections are there, all the parts, you know, are there any gaps or maybe some dirt on it, or you know, some missing parts, missing wires or connections, you would not prefer if there was a noise process like this. Of course, you would be arguing now. I mean, of course, I wouldn't be taking such a process image, but still, this is of course for the purpose of explaining the topic. Probably you won't see this much, but there could be some like the background noise in our environments. Background, remember, thermal noise effects, other type of artifacts or noise effects. Illumination, we said, of course, that's different kind of noise you have to get rid of. But you would always prefer to work with, or not always, let's say, but mainly prefer to work with a filtered, at least cleaned image, right? Like this one on the bottom right. So Lena, image Gaussian noise. Now it's trying to show if it's a Gaussian noise, you would not prefer a medium filter. Again, I'm back to this discussion on know which type of filter to apply to which type of image noise, corrupted that image. So if it was an additive Gaussian noise, we don't prefer a medium filter. We should prefer these original, actually classical filters of these weighted averaging type filters, and particularly the averaging type filters. Medium filtering, you see, is not really doing as we would want, but if the image was corrupted by an impulsive type or multiplicative type of noise, medium filter is doing a much better job. You see, most of the features are there. And guys, actually look at the borders of this image. You see, this image when doing this filtering was not padded correctly. And there are border artifacts, which is good. We see it. If you don't do a appropriate padding at the borders, you get these artifacts. Because why? Your filter, when it's at the borders, right? For instance, at this top corner, right, left corner, your filters coefficients, some of them are outside here with the medium filter also. That guy will be ordering a lot of the zeros there, right? I mean, there are many zero padded pixel values, and that will affect the median also. Although these guys are much more robust to noise, such impulsive type of outlier type of noise, still I see these artifacts. For instance, here a constant replication would be much better. It wouldn't affect my order statistics. So you should know what kind of padding you should do. Okay. More order statistics. You can come up with other types. So this is another example here. Let's maybe go over it. It goes through the image patch here, orders it. You see the medium filter would be really taking the center point here, the sorted from the sorted vector, 96, for instance. There is a midpoint filter, for instance. Again, you rank or order, combined order statistics and averaging. It takes the minimum value in this patch or in this window of the filter. Zero is the min, 255 is the max, and takes an average of the max and min, okay? Or there is an alpha trimmed mean, meaning, again, you sort your window, remove, for instance, D over 2 highest and lowest. For instance, let's say D was 2, you remove 1 lowest and 1 highest. So actually that would really be nice, because these are like probably outliers all of a sudden from 0 to 255. So you would remove this 1 at the beginning, the 0, the 1 at the top, the 255, and you would get an average of 55 to 157. For instance, this would be called alpha trim mean, right? In a way, it's like eliminating some of the outliers and taking an averaging filter. So you see order statistics filters are helping us here. And you see when D is zero, it's the arithmetic mean. When D is MN minus one, it's the medium filter. So now let's see some more examples, again, for the salt and pepper noise or impulsive noise corruption. Arithmetic mean filter doesn't work. This is the other type of example now. Again, applying the wrong type of filter, but medium filter works perfectly, almost perfectly, very nicely. Capturing, or the goal is in filtering is, of course, preserve the details and remove unwanted components, right? This is also called, in a way, feature extraction, because you try to extract features. Of course, at this point, it's not yet feature extraction, but still keeping, preserving original or important details, getting rid of unnecessary details. You guys can check these more in detail. Again, look at this image corrupted by this time, additive and uniform noises edit. And here, this time, I think it's salt and pepper noise on the right, uniform noise. So additive multiplicative noise. Left is additive, right is multiplicative. Using mean averaging filters, mean filters on in the middle, you see on the impulsive corrupted image, these don't work at all. But on the impulsive noise filter, noise image, this medium filter and also alpha trim mean, they both work quite well at the bottom. Okay. You can then come up with other variations. You can say, I'm going to combine, I want to make use of the advantages of both mean and medium. It could be because a mixed type of noise, or I'm not sure which type of noise I have in my image. It's mixed noise. I can say I'm going to use Gaussian and impulse, or I'm going to use a filter that responds to both. So you can design a blended mean and medium filter. But of course, there is a blending parameter here you have to fix or set, alpha. So apply the averaging filter, get your response, apply the medium filter, get your response, and blend these by a convex combination of the alpha. Of course, this alpha should be between 0 and 1, okay? There are more adaptive filters, adaptive to image characteristics. So it's like, typically we try to use some statistics from the images, local image characteristics. So don't give me a global rule. It's still a global rule, but use the local intensity values. For instance, let's look at this one. This is the adaptive local noise filtering method. Use a mean intensity and variance intensity, variance of the intensity in an image window. And also use some global intensity characteristics. So let's look at this patch from this Lena image from the face. You see, this was already corrupted by some impulsive type of noise. You see this black dot here, right? Actually, this was corrupted by also, I think, in RGB, because I see a red dot too. But let's assume it's a black dot here that was corrupting. So it will affect my variance, right? Also, it will affect the local mean. So what this will be trying to do is, if G is away from the local mean here, let's see if the black dot would be increasing my local variance, first of all, right? This sigma L square, this sigma is a noise estimate, noise variance estimate. So if I'm at the center, let's say, I would be away from the actually mean of this patch. The mean is mostly some lighter intensity value, right? So I am, I may be away from that value, but my variance is high, or exactly, actually not standard deviation, variance is high, and it's in the denominator, actually. So this will be really a small value, right? Then let me see, then this difference would be ML. I'm trying to see if I am at the dark pixel value here, or I am at a, I'm trying to see if I can get rid of this corruption in the image intensity, right? So if there is corruption, this sigma L square will be high. And actually, even if this distance is high, I am keeping my original intensity value. So if I'm not on that dark spot, but I am on the maybe middle intensity value, I would still be keeping my intensity value, this like the more common intensity value here. Let's assume we are on the dark spot. Guys, I'm trying to work out the case here. If I'm on the dark spot, this will be a small value, G. And however, even if this G is a small value, this will be a negative value, right? Because g is small, the local mean is larger than that. So actually, this is an addition because this is a negative value in the parentheses. It's a minus, and I'm adding on top of it actually. So I am trying to, my point is, don't get confused, I am trying to get closer to the more common average value by this operation. So this is one example, of course. This is just a very naive way of saying I'm going to use the local image statistics, the local mean, and the local variance to get rid of the to get an adaptive filter which will adapt itself to the local intensity characteristics or statistics. Works best with Gaussian and uniform noise still, it says. Actually, I was trying to work out whether it would work with such a dark spot. It won't do that bad, actually. I think it will still try to smooth that out. But here there is one point. You have to estimate the this background or noise variance of the overall noise. This is also unknown. You have to come up with a way to estimate that. That's another issue. So this is adaptive noise reduction filtered image here at the bottom. This was Gaussian noise, added corrupted noise. And you compare it to arithmetic mean filtered or geometric mean filtered result. Of course, these are very much naive filters, right? Very simple filters. This is at least looking at the one at the bottom right, is looking at some local image characteristics, statistics, mean and variance. So it's you can say it's doing a little bit better, but its blurring effect is less, right? These are blurring more. So this is not really doing bad, actually. So this is, again, adaptive contrast enhancement filter. This is, let's see, another version, you see. So people come up with these different expressions, actually. This time, again, you see the image at the center value or the, in the neighborhood, actually, of your filter is compared to the local mean. If this difference is high, you are trying to actually suppress that difference, right? This is relating to the coefficient of variation. In statistics, you know, coefficient variation is standard deviation over the mean. It models the dispersion for us. Okay? So imagine a low contrast area. This time, guys, I have to really mention it. We try to do a contrast enhancement, not filtering. So low contrast areas, we try to make them higher contrast. So when you see a small contrast area, low contrast area, we have low standard deviation. This sigma log here in this expression is low. So then you see it's in the denominator. So this coefficient is boosted. It gives us boosting. So actually it boosts this difference. And then it adds it on top of the local mean. That's actually enhancement rather than denoising. Do you see the idea here? Also, it's seeing saying this is also important. It's helpful to shrink the histogram before applying this filter. So exactly here, this is the crucial part here. There are some parameters like K1 and K2 varying between 0 and 1. And this is another important point in such filters or enhancement filters you define. You have to make sure you clip the image because your filtered values could go below 0. They could go above 255. It's like overflow, underflow. You have to make sure you clip them because otherwise you will see artifacts. They may actually just, when it's an overflow, it may go back to a 0, for instance, and you may really see these impulsive type looking artifacts. Always check the range, okay? You can apply the filter to each RGB channel separately or only in the intensity component. In this, remember, hue saturation value or intensity color space. For instance, this was a result that replied a variation of that adaptive that applied adaptive contrast enhancement to this image. You see, actually, it really enhanced well. You would prefer not to work with this more foggy or blurry looking image, but instead you would really want to work with this contrast enhanced image. It's 18, so maybe I show a few more examples and we can wrap up. This is another example. The image on the left is an input image from a Landsat satellite viewing the Earth. And then on the right, it's an enhanced image. Here, the geologists were interested in these dark lava flows, the salt, and things like that. So, of course, the domain experts should evaluate always such images. When you go to enhancement and such kind of processing, you may be doing something wrong. You may be really, while trying to, for instance, enhance the contrast in this image, maybe here the salt part is important. You may be really suppressing it. So in these physical, biological, medical, or such domains, actually, when you do process the data, also this is not just for images, but all kinds of data, you have to work with a domain expert and ask them if this is the right kind of data processing they would prefer. If it's really suppressing important details, then you have to go to or devise a new or other kind of feature extractor, okay? Here, for instance, this is an example where they were happy and has contrast in dark light areas. And they were interested in the surface detail here, which was suppressed on the original image. You see there was low contrast here. Now you see more surface details in these areas, also these areas, all these textures. If you are interested in this texture in the rocks here, actually this was a very good image enhancement, okay?